reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Sing your presence. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face. We're looking to the sky, descending like a cloud. You're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens,
we wanna sing.
Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing like a
heart,
filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Look up to Him and ask Him, show us your glory, Lord. We sing,
show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Come on, sing it.
Show us your glory.
Show us your power.
Show us your glory, Lord.
We sing.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Open up the heavens,
open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing like
your heart, filling every part of our praise.
For the last time, open up.
Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
We sing,
show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
With your voices.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Amen. Let's give God a clap offering. Oh God, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Let's sing it.
Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame,
Through the cross, you are the truth. You are the life. You are the way. Sing it again. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross, you are the truth. You are the life. You are the way. The Lord has called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. Praise to our God. Let's sing it.
I once was fatherless, a stranger with no hope. Your kindness wakened me from my sleep now. Your love, it beckons deeply. You are called to come and die. By grace now I will come and take this life, take your life. Sin has lost its power. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you've risen victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth. You are the light. You are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth. You are the life. You are the way. My dead heart now is beating, my deepest stains now clean. Your breath fills up my lungs, and now I'm free, now I'm free.
Amen!
My dead heart now is beating, my deepest stains now clean. Your breath fills up my lungs, and now I'm free, now I'm free. Sin has lost its power. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you've risen victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running,
out of darkness, out of shame.
Through the cross you are the truth. You are the light. You are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth. You are the life. You are the way.
We lift our hands in glory for what the Lord has done for us. There is freedom in Jesus Christ. Amen. Sing.
Lift my hands and spin around. See the light that I have found. Oh, the marvelous light, lift my hands and spin around. See the light that I have found. Oh, the marvelous light, lift my hands and spin around. See the light that I have found. Oh, the marvelous light.
Sing it.
Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through
Through the cross, you are the truth. You are the life. You are the way. Into marvelous light, I am running. Out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross, you are the truth. You are the life. You are the way. Songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Let's praise his name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Sing Jesus.
Jesus, in your name we pray. Lord, come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name.
Let's claim it.
Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name is a nation singing louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save.
Sing your name.
Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
Church, there is power in the name of Jesus. And as we continue to play this song, I'd like you to think about such a thing that you are claiming from the Lord. Maybe there's something that you are struggling that no, that you cannot do. The Lord, the Bible says that it is not by might, it is not by power, but by the Spirit of the Lord that we can do things. And Lord, we claim that truth. We claim that promise today, oh God. Lord, help us. You are our helper. The psalm says that I lift up my eyes to the hills, and where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, the mighty God. And today, church, let's claim this song. Let's claim that the name of God, the name of Jesus, reigns over all our hearts, reigns over our lives. And so today, I'd like you to think of that as you sing this song. Whatever difficulties, whatever obstacle that you need help from the Lord, declare it in Jesus' name. And as we sing it for the last time, put that in mind.
Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save.
Sing your name. But your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you save us. You are our Savior. You save us from sin. You save us from death. You save us even from ourselves and Satan and the enemy. And we thank you, Lord, that we can find shelter in you. You are our rock and you are our refuge. So, Lord, today as we come to you, Lord, we offer our lives and dedicate them to you. We surrender our hands, O God. Give you our hearts. Give you our minds, Lord, as we listen to your word. This is our prayer, Lord God. Let's offer our lives to Him. Let's sing this chorus. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your... Lord, I give you my heart. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. Sing that last line, Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, this is our prayer as individuals and as a church, O God. We come to you with humble hearts, Lord, ready to hear from you. Thank you, God, for your word, your living word, sharper than any two-edged sword, Lord, that could pierce our hearts. Thank you, O God, for your word, the gospel that will be preached today, and may the power of your word be planted in our hearts, and we, as we leave this place, Lord, never the same again. We praise you, O Lord Father. We praise you, Jesus Christ. We praise you, Holy Spirit. And we exalt you forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our reading for today is from Mark chapter 9, verses 30 to 37. They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. They went to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "If anyone wants to be first, he must be the very last and the servant of all." He took a little child and had him stand among them. Taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." This is the reading of the word. You may be seated.
If the size difference was not obvious, but I'm just introducing Pastor AJ. I'm sure he's a pastor who you guys are quite familiar with, who needs no introduction, but this is more for him, so we can kind of warm him up to things, you know. He is our powerlifting pastor. He goes to the gym, lifts like 500 pounds. But don't let that intimidate you. He goes home and his two daughters softens him up, overcompensates on that. I think that for me personally, AJ, when I was in New Jersey and doing ministry there, he's just, he's been a pastor to me and a brother, and he's definitely been one of those guys who, on a day-to-day basis, just walks with you. Yeah, he's not just, you know, a Sunday pastor, and that was something that I really admired about him. So without further ado, AJ. Oh, he's the pastor of ICF.
Good morning, QBC. Before anything else, could you do me a favor, just keep your Bibles open to that main text that we had read, Mark chapter 9, verses 30 through 37. I just want to say, as always, thank you for having me. I'm able to be here with my wife, Renata, this morning. We left our two kids with my parents, mostly because I asked Renata if she wanted to come with me. She said, yeah. I asked her if she wanted us to bring the kids with us. She was like, if we bring the kids, I'm not going to be able to do anything else. So you have to keep that in mind. I was like, we'll let mom and dad watch the kids. It's cool. It's always awesome being here, even as we came in a little later today than we normally would have. Just being immediately welcomed into your presence with warm familiarity is something I'm always super thankful for. It's one of the things I love about coming to QBC. And you know that I'm familiar with the people here when people are going to crack jokes about me even before I come up. When Kev's going to talk about me being big and then talk about me being soft with my kids. And I can't even say anything about that because that it's super true. Every time I think I'm tough, I get home and these little girls just own me somehow. And that's okay. And RJ too. Like I wasn't going to sweat enough coming up here. But when I prepared my sermon for Mark chapter 9, he quickly introduces me saying that I'm going to preach on Nehemiah. And in that moment, I was ready, guys, to pull a trick out of the book where for a couple minutes, I would have explained the lost art of just reading nothing but scripture during your Sunday sermon. And I would have said how it's this pastime that needs to be revived, and we would have done nothing but read through passages of Nehemiah. And my job would have been done. But we're going into Mark chapter 9 today, and if you would give me the pleasure of just leading us in prayer one more time, because we can't pray too much. That just doesn't exist. Let's pray. Lord Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning where we could be with you. I thank you for giving me this chance to be with QBC this morning. I pray that you would bless us with the leading of your Holy Spirit as we go into your word. I pray that you would remind us that even if we think it's something that we know in scripture already, remind us that you breathe life into it the way that you breathe life into us. And that being the case, there's no end to what we can learn about you, know about you, and enjoy and find joy in when it comes to the fact that you are endless. So I pray that you'd speak through me, because there's not enough good in me to do this on my own. I pray that anything comes out of my mouth that's not from you, that those things would fall upon deaf ears, fall to the ground. But if your truth comes out, God, I pray that you would stir within us in a way that is unavoidable, in a way that calls us to a response. Because when we have genuine encounters with you, we can't even pretend to be the same. So I pray that as we leave here later on, we would look less like ourselves and more reflective of your son, Jesus. Our prayer is that we would be able to love you more. We thank you. All this we pray in the name of your son. Amen. I'll start out by saying this. Everybody wants to be somebody. Ultimately, that's going to be the title of our sermon this morning. Everybody wants to be somebody, including me. And for me, this was best shown when I was in middle school through high school, and I went through this phase that I see a lot of guys going through, particularly if you grow up Filipino, or maybe not just Filipino, but for me, when I was between 9 and say 15, basketball was my life. And that's weird for me to say now because, you know, when I was in high school, I used to be able to stand underneath a hoop, and without having to take a running start, I'd be able to jump up and grab under a rim. I tried this last week, and I took my running start, and I barely grazed the net. And when I landed on the ground, my knees were killing me. So both weight and age has taken its toll on me. But teenage me, yeah, ball was life. And I remember there was one point where I was going through transitions in adolescence where I was no longer quite into basketball culture, but it was still something I liked a lot. When I was in high school, I started getting more into punk rock. So, and that started dictating the way that I dressed. So all of a sudden, I traded in going to school in basketball shorts and sneakers to wearing tighter jeans, t-shirts, and chains everywhere and thinking I was a punk. Except there was this one camp that we went to where all of a sudden we had a little bit of a basketball tournament. And there was this little part of me where I was like, this is my chance. This is my chance to show everybody. Everybody thought they knew what I was about, but little did they know that this punk rock kid had some moves on the court. So I did something. And to say that I tried too hard would be a gross understatement. I was all over the place. I was sweating. I was drooling on everybody. In like 10 minutes, I took like 50 shots and I didn't pass the ball once. And out of those 50 shots, I made like 3. And I remember sitting down and a couple guys on my team were like, what are you doing, bro? Oh, thanks a lot, man. TJ has my back. So there, and I remember another game was coming up and I was ready to come up. You know, here's me still wearing all my punk rock chainmail and stuff. And a couple guys were like, you could sit this one out. And it was one of these moments where I looked back and I was like, I wish I could have done this differently. I wish that I didn't have to look at this as like, this is like my one chance to shine and impress everybody. And I would have passed the ball more, and I probably would have worn sneakers instead of the Converse shoes that I was wearing, which is, even though it started out as a basketball shoe, is not really appropriate for sports now. But it kind of brings to light that this is something that we all go through. We all want to be somebody. And that's something that we see mainly as one of the main points in the text that we're looking at today. So again, let's go to Mark chapter 9, verse 30. And here it says, they went on from there and passed through Galilee. And he didn't want anyone to know, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And when he's killed, after 3 days, he will rise. So what we see here is actually the second foretelling of his suffering, of his death and his resurrection. And I'm assuming a couple weeks ago, you were able to see his first foretelling of it. We find it in chapter 8 of the book of Mark, in verse 31. I'll read that again real quick. So Mark 8:31 says, and he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days he'll rise again. So that was the first instance where he spoke. And if you remember this account, we remember one thing as well. We remember that Peter responded in such a way that he said, you must never suffer. And Jesus responds to Peter by saying what? He says, get thee behind me, Satan. As if Peter was being used in a way to tempt him away from what he was called to do, ultimately. So here in chapter 8, we see Christ foretelling about his suffering, and Peter didn't understand. In chapter 9, we see something similar, where he's foretelling about his death and his resurrection, and they, again, just didn't understand. And we see something interesting, because in verse 32 it says, they didn't understand the saying, and they were afraid to ask him. And before we get even into our main points today, we're going to pause right here and say this. Don't be afraid to come to our God for anything. Go to him with everything. Know that he wants all of you. He wants you in your entirety. In fact, he died for you in your entirety. Don't reserve anything away from him, because he doesn't just love the parts of you that understand him. He wants every ounce of you. So they're afraid to ask, and we can ask as to why. Maybe they were just afraid that even if he answered, it'd still be beyond their understanding. Maybe they're afraid that if they asked, Jesus was going to call somebody Satan again, and they'd be embarrassed. He was like, oh man, I remember what happened to Peter the last time he said something when Jesus was talking about dying. I'm not going to be the one who says something this time because Jesus is going to call me Satan in front of everybody, and I'd just rather not go through that because Peter looked like he didn't really have a good time when that happened to him. So let's just avoid this altogether. But what's interesting here in our text is, as Jesus is speaking of his suffering, the disciples fight over their position. And that's what we see in the next couple of verses. In the next couple of verses it says, as they come to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, what were you discussing on the way? And then it says this, they kept silent. It says they kept silent because on the way they argued with one another about who was the greatest. It's one of these awkward silences where it's like, oh man, I know we just messed up and now Jesus knows. Because it's not as if Jesus doesn't know. One, he's God and he's all-knowing. Nothing is hidden from him. And two, he was literally walking with them as they were fighting. So it's not like Jesus doesn't know what's going on, and it's not like Jesus doesn't know that they were arguing over who is the greatest. Mind you, it's also kind of insulting that they're arguing over who's the greatest when Jesus is here talking about his death and his resurrection. It's like priorities, guys. Come on. So there's this awkward silence, and they're fighting, and I had this conversation with TJ earlier where we kind of can't help but talk about these illustrations that involve our kids. And one of the things we talked about this morning was that our kids are, both of our sets of kids are at this age where they typically like to compete with each other for our affections. Where even at home, when we're having dinner with our two daughters, we'll go to our youngest one, Aura, and she's eating dinner and she's finally eating like her whole meal, and we'll say, good job, Aura. And the second we say that, Noah puts down her spoon and she's like, but what about me? And we have these moments where sometimes, like, we'll go to our kids and we'll say, something TJ told me earlier. He's like, you know, you'll say to one of your kids, I love you so much. And another kid will pop out of the side and be like, but who do you love more? It was like, Dad, I mean, you and I, we got this special bond going. And I know that you love my brother, but you love me more, right? And if we're gonna be honest, it's this mentality that's still hard to shake, because everybody wants to be somebody, as we said. And if we're gonna be honest, we can't be mad at them. We can't be mad at the disciples for having this kind of ambition. Because this is human. Like we said, this is something we all go through. Not only that, ambition can be an awesome thing. It can be a driving force. Ambition is the driving force that has astronauts go into space, that has doctors spend tireless hours in hospitals. It's what sends missionaries overseas to share the gospel. But what Jesus is doing here is he's trying to get us past self-seeking ambition where we're just trying to make names for ourselves. Because being great is one thing, and what he doesn't rebuke ambition here. Instead, he's trying to get us to see that we're not just talking about greatness. Because if we're going to be honest in this situation, the disciples were arguing in such a way where they wanted to be seen as great in the eyes of other people. And not only that, they wanted to be seen greater than somebody else, because they were arguing over who was greater. They're fighting over their positions, like a bunch of birds in a pecking order in a lot of ways. What Jesus is doing is something awesome. He's trying to harness that ambition. Kind of like you're trying to tame a wild horse. You're not trying to kill its energy or its drive. You're just trying to harness it and turn it into something even more useful and productive. So we bring up these questions. What makes you great? What makes you great? If we're going to go by societal norms, money makes you great, power makes you great, success makes you great. What's weird is my wife and I had conversations yesterday where we were talking about what it means to make it today and how we have certain celebrities that really left a bad mark on what it means to be somebody today, because we have a bunch of people who think that, you know what, I can make it on my own terms, where, you know, a lot of kids are trying to be YouTube famous now and they'd rather pour all their interest into, you know, promoting their channel. I'm not saying that that's a bad thing, but if that's all you're going to work on because the Kardashians showed us that you could be famous for absolutely nothing, society's norms on what it means to be great has kind of messed us up. So we also pin this up around scripture, and we remember, again, you guys studied in Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 38, scripture is consistent with teaching us about self-denial. And we're going to go into this more and more. So according to God's standard, according to biblical standard, the question is this: if everybody wants to be somebody, what does it mean to be great? How does one become great? In order to really look at this, one of the things that we're bringing up right now is this: we need to know that greatness, true greatness, comes at a cost. Everything comes at a price. Even greatness comes at a cost. This is something that we're teaching our kids at a really young age, even. Like I said, I make a lot of illustrations about my kids because it's something that God uses in my life to teach me a lot of things, and it shows me the responsibility we have to pass on truth to younger people. But through no fault of her own, it's not like she had to learn how to do this. Our eldest daughter stole a lot of stuff when she was younger. I remember Renata and I would be in malls, and I'd be waiting for them to come out. And as Renata would be pushing our daughter Noah in a stroller, they'd be coming out of J. Crew, and I'd be wondering, I was like, why does Noah have like 8 pairs of pants on the stroller? I was like, did you really need that many pairs of pants? And then she goes around, she was like, I didn't buy any of those. And I'm just like, so that means Noah, on the way through the store, as Renata's doing her own shopping, she's just grabbing things off the racks and stuffing them in the stroller. And it's one of these moments where we had to sit her down. It was like, we can't just take these because these aren't free. You got to pay for these. It's one of these things that, again, we have to teach the truth that everything comes at a price. Everything has a cost. And we even consider the free gift of salvation comes at a cost. The gift of salvation is only free for you and I because Christ paid for it with his life and with his blood. And this reminds us that while grace is free, grace is not cheap by any means. So let's not treat it as if it is. So we come to this idea, what does it mean to become great? And if we would read through this again, Jesus answers this. So let's put up verse 34 again. So it says here, but they kept silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. And Jesus has this awesome response where he doesn't smack him in the back of the head or anything, as tempting as that may have been. If you're a parent, I'm guessing you know that temptation. My kids respond more to timeouts at times, so. But what he does is this, he sits them down. He sits them down and he calls the 12 and he says to them, if anyone would be first, he must be last of all and a servant of all. What does it take to be great? It takes this willingness to become last and to become a servant of all. And this is best exemplified and best personified in the person of Jesus. If you would jot down John chapter 13, verses 3 through 6, I'm going to read that real quick. If we could turn to that on the PowerPoint, that'd be cool too. John 13. John John 13:3-6 says, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments and, taking a towel, tied it around his waist. And then he poured the water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, why do you wash my feet? And Jesus answered him, why I am doing you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand. We have to remember that Jesus sat in a really high position. Jesus, both being the Son of God and God, was at his rightful place in heaven. And he chose to forsake all of that, not to come down here and reign, but he comes down here and for some reason assumes the position of a servant, of a slave, and he washes the dirty, sweaty feet of the people who were following him. And we gotta say, this is what the church in action needs to look like. And I'll say that again. This is what the church in action needs to look like. And by action, I mean this. The church needs to be active. The church can't just sit around thinking warm, fuzzy feelings about God. Okay? One of the things that we've been going through in our church that's been cool is we've been going around to all of our small groups, and we've been working with them in such a way that we've been doing relational evangelism coaching. But even as we did this, we would go around to small groups and we'd say, there are these groups that are super deep in their knowledge of Scripture, but aren't really spending time with anybody outside of the church. And one of the only things that would come to mind is this. You would have to wonder if we as a church are going deeper in Scripture but aren't going wider in evangelism, do we run the risk of becoming God fat? And by that I refer to the fact where if you eat in excess and don't do enough exercise, you're going to gain weight and not the good kind. And the same is going to be true. You wonder if all you're going to do is read Scripture and feel a whole bunch of warm, fuzzy feelings about God and not go out and do what you are missionally called to. What productive, what good is going to come out of that? It's awesome. Yes, we're supposed to dwell on the goodness of our God for the rest of our lives, and coming together and celebrating Him is a command. But we cannot avoid the fact that it was never meant to stay here. We are meant to go out and reach out in a way that we are becoming servants to all, because there's something about being servants to all, even those who grow increasingly hostile to the church, that draws them closer to the Lord when they see us assuming a lowly position. But we're going to be honest. Like we said, greatness comes at a cost. And it costs a lot. It costs a lot of time. It costs a lot of effort. It costs a lot of money. It costs a lot of energy. But here's another truth. Where our eyes are fixed determine whether or not we find it worth it. And by that I mean this. When we consider the cost, if we only look at ourselves, we typically only focus on how hard this is going to be for me, how uncomfortable this is going to be for me. And then we tend to feel like it's just asking too much of me because I'm not good enough. And so that we say, get off yourself. Something awesome and amazing happens when we fix our eyes on Jesus and we look upward, that has us respond in such a way where we say, God, you're so good that whatever it takes, I'm yours. If it means me being able to have more and more of you, whatever it takes, take my life. And this ends up being paradoxical in just a beautiful way. And Scripture tends to be like that, right? we find these awesome paradoxes where things that just don't make sense somehow make sense. Things like somehow in our weaknesses we are found to be strong. We find that we can go from death to life. And the paradox that we find here is that somehow in not holding on to everything, and not holding on to anything, we could have everything. In living with these open-handed lives where we're not trying to manipulate everything around us in order to hold on to the things that are near and dear to us, and living with open hands instead, we're saying, God, I want to hold on to this myself. It means a lot, but do with it as you wish. In doing so, we can have everything because He is everything. So the paradox of greatness is that it comes in service to other people. So again, we bring up this issue, how is greatness personified? It's greatly personified in the life of Jesus. But as we look at verses 36 and 37, we see it says, oh, I just dropped something. 36, it says, and he took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me. And this brings up some questions. Why is Jesus using a child in this illustration? What sense does this make? You think about who a child was at the time, and we know a couple things for sure. A child had few rights, had no privileges. A child is completely dependent on other people, particularly adults, and children are vulnerable. In a lot of ways, this child represents the lowly. This child represents the weak, the marginalized, and those who are down and out. And Jesus brings up this question, would you take him in? Not only does this child represent the lowly, children in this sense also represent somebody who has really nothing to offer you. And by that I mean, if you were to host a child in your home, you would have nothing to gain from it. If you're hosting somebody in your town, say the mayor or the chief of police, you have something to gain in being hospitable to this person and receiving them warmly. But he's saying, here's a child who is completely dependent and really has nothing to offer you. There's zero political gain to him. Would you receive him? And I gotta be honest, I love my kids for a very specific reason. They're mine. I don't really like other kids as much. I love a lot of kids. A lot of kids are real nice to me. You know, some of them get to like a weird age though, where once kids start acting up, I kind of go, I'm gonna text your mom so she can pick you up real quick. Because the beauty about other kids is when they start acting up, they got somewhere else to go. But my kids, you know, I'll unconditionally love them, though they too get pretty tiring, where if my wife or I have to spend a whole day with both of them, by the end of the day, we're kind of playing, like tagging each other, like wrestling style, where we say, hey, it's your turn, watch him for an hour, I'm gonna take a nap after I pop a Tylenol real quick. So the question is, still, would you receive this child when you have nothing to gain? And here's what it means. The mark and the call of true discipleship is when it's genuine. This is the mark and the call of genuine discipleship. By this, when I refer to the fact when we do discipleship in a way that I have nothing in terms of title or position to gain from it. And if you think about the world that we live in today, in an age of increasing skepticism and hostility towards Christians and the church, people need to see Christians being genuine and generous with their affection. So when we disciple others, we do it not for our own gain, but we do it for their growth and for God's glory. That's how we personify greatness, and that's how we reflect Jesus in this. So to close, we kind of bring up this question, now what? Because like I said, this was never meant to merely stir some warm, fuzzy feelings in your heart. But hopefully this can also be a call to action. Because no matter where you are in this life's journey, we believe that there is always a way to move forward, and there's always a way where we can increase in our ability to reflect Jesus. We've been doing something kind of different in ICF lately. We're referring to it as Simple Church, and it's not as if we're trying to do things differently, but we're trying to frame things differently in such a way we're trying to strip away some of the extra frills in terms of church, where we thought about what we were called to do. And what we're really called to do in simple terms is we're called to love God, we're called to grow together, and we're called to reach the world. So if we bring that to you right now, I don't know where you are, but I know that there's always a way to level up in terms of your commitment. Maybe you've been hearing about Jesus, but you haven't really quite given your life to him. And maybe you feel like you've given your life to him, but you've only given it to him in parts. Maybe it's time to really love him in a way that you're giving him the entirety of your being. Love God. Maybe you've been hanging out here at QBC for a while. And one of the things that RJ talked about earlier, he was talking about the small groups that you have around the area. We believe that something awesome happens when people come together, where we can, if this is the time where you can hear me speak about Scripture, small groups is a place where you can interact through Scripture, as well as grow deeper in your relationships with each other, where you could learn to really have each other's backs. This is where real community takes place. So you can go deeper in community, go deeper in discipleship, and it's also a place where you can begin to be further equipped to do the last thing, which is reach the world. This is, again, we can't leave out this calling for the church. We're reaching the world by going out, sharing the love that we had found, but also by serving them and taking this lowly position, because we tend to win people over, not from a pedestal, but while we're kneeling. And we're going to invite them to go along on the same process, to love God, grow deeper with us, so that, again, we can go out and further reach the world. So everybody wants to be somebody. But the question is, are you willing to do what it takes? And if that seems hard for you, my encouragement is to not fix our eyes on ourselves, but to look to God and let it fuel your commitment to him. Because again, when we tend to come to know how good our God is, we tend to say, whatever it takes, whatever the cost. We tend to have this all-in mentality when we could get our eyes off of ourselves. Because when it comes to being great in a real sense, it tends to be less about how many boards you're sitting on, and it tends to be more about how many feet you're willing to wash. Let's close in prayer. Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning where we could be with you. Thank you for letting me be here with QBC where we could journey through this together. Lord, you know that I can't stand up here as somebody who has this down perfectly, but at the same time, that's kind of the beauty of this, that we all are a work in progress, but we see in Scripture that he who began a good work will also be faithful to complete it. So Lord, our prayer is that you would work within us so that you could work through us. Lord, our prayers that you would do with us as you wish. We thank you. We love you. All this we pray in the name of your Son. Amen. Thank you, everybody.